in science and mathematics in 10th. After that, I chose humanities. While most of them discouraged me, but she encouraged. I chose this particularly because I wanted to take up civil service exam with psychology and sociology. From that young age, I had decided that I'll do this exam with these subjects. So this was one occasion where she stood up. And the second occasion was when I chose IPS, which is a male-dominated field, as opposed to IAS, even with a rank as high as 43, where I could have landed up in IAS. So that was again another moment. So later on, I caught up with myself, whatever she laid the foundation for. So definitely it's my mother.
Namaskar. Good morning, all of you. सबसे पहले मेरी सफलता मेरे अकेले की नहीं थी, इसमें बहुत लोगों का सपोर्ट था. सबसे पहले टाटा स्टील, जिन्होंने एक 48 साल की महिला के ऊपर विश्वास किया और मेरे सारे अभियानों को स्पॉन्सर किया, और बहुत सारी महिलाओं का सपोर्ट मुझे मिला. सबसे पहले मेरी माँ, जिन्होंने मुझे अच्छे संस्कार दिए. और आज से 40 साल पहले कभी लड़का और लड़की में डिफरेंस नहीं किया. हमेशा ये बोलती थी, तुम बहुत स्ट्रांग हो, जैसा लड़का स्ट्रांग होता है वैसे ही तुम भी स्ट्रांग हो. तो एक ये कूट कूट के अंदर था कि मैं बहुत स्ट्रांग हूँ. और उसके बाद मेरी गुरु बजेंद्री पाल जी, भारत की पहली महिला एवरेस्ट विजेता, जिन्होंने मुझे अपने आप पर विश्वास करना सिखाया. मैं तो अपनी बेटियों को लेकर गई थी उनके पास एडवेंचर स्पोर्ट्स में डालने के लिए, लेकिन उन्होंने मुझे एनकरेज किया कि तुम भी कर सकती हो, तुम क्यों नहीं. और उसके बाद मेरी बेटियाँ, मेरी बड़ी बेटी प्रियंशा, जब मैं एवरेस्ट के लिए जा रही थी तो एक साल पहले उसकी शादी हुई थी. और हमारी कम्युनिटी में साल भर बहुत सारे ऐसे फंक्शंस रहते हैं जो कि मुझे इंगेज रहना पड़ता, और उसी समय मुझे एवरेस्ट जाने की तैयारी करनी थी. और एक ऑर्डिनरी हाउसवाइफ, जॉइंट फैमिली, बहुत सारे हेडर्स मेरे पास थे. तो उसने कहा कि नहीं, मैं अपने ससुराल को मैनेज कर लूँगी, आप अपने मिशन पे फोकस करो. और मेरी छोटी बेटी, उसने MBA कंप्लीट कर लिया था और जॉब की तलाश में थी. और क्योंकि मुझे घर भी देखना था, एवरेस्ट के लिए 3 महीने बाहर रहना था, इतने फिटनेस के लिए प्रैक्टिस करनी थी, तो उसने कहा कि आप एकदम बेफिक्र होके जाओ, मैं घर परिवार देख लूँगी, जॉइंट दादी पेरेंट्स सबको मैं देख लूँगी, आप जाओ.
I'll just translate for better. She said that first of all, I think I'm all good.
So firstly, she said that her success is not hers alone, and she has received the support of innumerable people, especially at the Tata Group, who trusted her at the age of 48 and decided to sponsor all of her activities and initiatives. But the first woman that she would credit with her success is her mother, for giving her such an upbringing that even 40 years ago, she saw no difference in a boy or a girl. It didn't matter, and even though men were always traditionally considered to be strong even 40 years ago, she ingrained it in her that she is just as strong as a man. The second person that she gives credit to is Bachendri Pal, who's the first Indian female who climbed the Mount Everest, who taught her to trust in herself and have faith in herself. She actually in fact took her daughters for adventure sports training to Bachendri Pal, but Bachendri Pal asked her, why not you, why just your daughters? Why can't you do it as well? She also gave credit to her 2 daughters, especially her elder daughter who got married 1 year before she left for climbing the Mount Everest. And in Indian families, typically you have functions after the wedding still even a year. You have a lot of rituals that are going on. And at the same time, she had to prepare for the expedition that she was doing. And there were a lot of responsibilities. She considers herself that she came as just an ordinary housewife. She came from a joint family. There were a lot of responsibilities. But still, her eldest daughter inspired her to go. And her youngest daughter, in fact, decided to take up the care of the household while her mother was training for her mission, even though she had just gotten her MBA degree and she was looking for jobs. But she told her that she would look after the household while her mother did the fitness training, and she would take care of running the family.
It's a pleasure for me to be here. Very distinguished company. I might deviate a little bit, for which you'll have to forgive me. But I am also the oldest in this panel, and I like to think, though I'm sure most women feel that way because everybody has their struggles, that I belong to the transitional generation in India, where any little change in the or wavering of decision making would have had my life take a very different turn. So I grew up in a very strange kind of environment, that I went to a boarding school, I went to a very elite boarding college. My father was a serviceman, we were not rich landlords. I'm from Punjab, which has a very peculiar culture. But he retired when I was in class 8 and chose to settle in the village. So we would come home for 3.5 months to the village for our holidays and then go back to school. So it was literally a diametrically opposite life. So when I graduated, the pressure, the family tradition, extended family tradition was, it wavered. You know, sometimes if you found a good man, get her married straight out of school. Sometimes they would be generous and say, okay, let her finish her BA, we look for a guy then. So I had done well in school and college, and so when the issue of marriage came up, I resisted. I did not want to have an arranged marriage. I cannot explain the reasons. Maybe it was just pig-headedness or sense of independence that I had developed. So when things reached a real dead end, the person who really inspired me was my father, because he never once tried to pressure me, despite all, and he encouraged me to sit for the civil service exam. As luck would have it, I made it. If I hadn't, my life would have been very different. I get into the IAS, and then at age 33, I go through a very, very a dramatic tragedy, I would say. Dramatic, I say, because it was in the national press, national papers. My husband was an IPS officer in Punjab, and Punjab was going through a secessionist movement. He died in a terrorist attack. My daughter was one, and my son was three. So I had to cope with the attention, media attention, which I avoided, focus on bringing up my children, focus with in-laws family that was obsessed with their land, thinking that I might stake a claim and they might have to give up their land. That was the last thing on my mind. I was not interested. I had a salary, I had, you know, a life, and I didn't want to get into that. Anyway, the thing that I found, you know, the social attitudes to women. Everybody in India would, if they hadn't met you before, the first question they would ask is, what does your husband do? And it was very difficult for me to, in the initial years, to tell them that he was no more. So my son would go to school, and teachers would say, he would come and say, Mom, I don't want to go to school because teachers say Ajit doesn't have a father. So I had an opportunity to come on a posting to the embassy, and I did not say no. So when we came, it was like lifting a big weight of tragedy off your mind. And my children flourished because a single parent family was no different to any other. And then when my term with the embassy was over, I decided that I didn't want to take my children back to that atmosphere where my son had to go with a police officer to school every day and, you know, literally sort of be shadowed. So I chose at age 41 to go to Cornell. I got 2 degrees at Cornell, and I took a job with the ADB. I had an option to work for the bank or the ADB. I chose ADB because it would give me the support system in the home which I would need to manage the travels in my job so my children would be taken care of. When they went to college, then I went to the World Bank. I lived in Africa. So, you know, at Cornell, I realized in my first year, I did all kinds of courses. And my advisor asked me, if you're trying to sell your skills, what skill are you going to sell? You know, I had done all kinds of courses. But anyway, I could not finish my thesis in the 2 semesters. I had to stay for the summer. So I enrolled, you know, I decided I would enroll in the PhD program. And I realized that education is at the base of everything. anything you want to do, education is the foundation on which you can build. So I decided to pursue a degree in education. And that brought me to my international jobs where you're dealing with governments, and there has, since the 90s, there has been an emphasis on girls' education. And I, with the Indian context, I want to tell you that my thesis was in Haryana, because at that time it was believed that if you have a well-functioning school and people have a good income, girls will go to school. That's not the case. Because Haryana was number two in, you know, in per capita incomes, and it had a school in every village. But it was very revealing, the interviews, that everybody said that, oh, we have a primary school, but we won't send our girl to a middle school in the neighboring village because the atmosphere is bad. You know, in Hindi they use the word mahol, mahol kharab hai. So the girls did not, you know, there was no assumption that girl, and then they said, oh, if she's only to study up to fifth grade, what difference does it make if she drops out after second or third grade? But the emphasis on girls' education in other countries has resulted in most developing countries in the initial years of school education, now you have more girls than boys. So the focus also needs to shift on boys, because empowerment of girls is not going to come from women alone. You need to have supportive men for girls to be empowered. And I think that's something we forget, because my own life, I owe pretty much to my father's sense of empowerment. Thank you.
Namaskar, Ram Ram sir, good morning. वैसे मैं तो मतलब बाड़मेर जिले के रूरल एरिया से छोटे से गांव से हूँ और जब 4 साल की थी तो माँ की डेथ हो गई और पिताजी की दूसरी शादी हो गई और 6 बहने उनसे हैं तो मैं 7 बहने हैं उनके चलते 8वीं में स्कूल छूट गया और 17 साल की थी तो शादी हो गई शादी के बाद भी घर की आर्थिक स्थिति ठीक नहीं थी तो जब मेरी पहली संतान हुई तो उसको भी मैं नहीं बसा पाई तो जिनकी में एकदम ऐसा लगा कि अब जीने से क्या फ़ायदा सब कुछ तो भगवान ने छीन लिया है या तो अब ज़िंदगी ख़त्म कर ली जाए लेकिन फिर भी सोचा नहीं कुछ काम करूँगी लेकिन उस एरिया से आके क्या काम कर सकती है जो कम पढ़ी लिखी है और घर से बाहर जाना भी अलाउ नहीं है या तो सोचा कि किसी के घर में जाके झाड़ू पोछा कर लूँ या कंस्ट्रक्शन का काम कर लूँ लेकिन नहीं फिर भी सोचा कि बचपन में दादी से साथ बैठ के कसीदाकारी का काम सीखा था इसी से कुछ करूँगी लेकिन उसका मार्केट कहाँ है कैसे करूँगी वो कोई आइडिया नहीं था लेकिन फिर भी सुई धागा लेके कसीदाकारी का काम शुरू कर दिया जब लगा कि अब अकेली तो नहीं कर पा रही हूँ क्योंकि सुई धागे का काम है एम्ब्रॉयडरी का काम है वो तो मैं कर सकती थी लेकिन स्टिचिंग के लिए मशीन मेरे पास नहीं थी और वो खरीदने की कैपेसिटी नहीं थी तो फिर अड़ोस पड़ोस की और महिलाओं से बात की कि मैं अकेली कुछ नहीं कर पा रही हूँ लेकिन अपन मिल के करेंगे तो कुछ शायद कर पाएंगे तो हमने 10 महिलाओं का एक सेल्फ हेल्प ग्रुप बनाया और 100-100 रुपये इकट्ठा करके एक सेकेंड हैंड मशीन खरीदी और उससे हमने काम शुरू किया अब हम 10 महिलाएं थी और काम लाना एक चैलेंज था हमारे लिए कि हम काम कहाँ से लेके आएंगे अब 10 महिलाओं के लिए इतना आसान नहीं था तो फिर हमने जो अभी हमें प्रेजिडेंट हो ग्रामीण विकास चेतना संस्था उनके बारे में पता चला और उनके फाउंडर हैं विक्रम सिंह जी और अभी सेक्रेटरी भी है तो उनसे हम जाके मिले कि हमारे 10 महिलाओं का एक समूह है और हम काम करना चाहते हैं अगर आप हमारी कोई हेल्प करो तो पहले तो उन्होंने बोला कि यहाँ पे महिलाएं काम करती नहीं है करना नहीं चाहती है एक दिन आते हैं दूसरे दिन कोई काम वापस नहीं आते हैं लेकिन हमने बोला हमारी मतलब हम काम की ज़रूरत है आप अगर हमारी कोई हेल्प कर पाए तो हम वापस जरूर आएंगे तो उन्होंने हमें सैंपलिंग का काम दिया और जब हम सैंपल बना के लेके गए तो उन्हें पसंद आया और उसके बाद में हमें 3 दिन का ऑर्डर दिया गया वो ऑर्डर का काम हम लेके गए और दूसरे दिन ही वापस गए तो हमें बोला कि आप तो मैंने बोला ना आपसे काम नहीं होगा कल लेके गए और सुबह आ गए वापस मैंने कहा हम काम करके लेके आए हमने पूरी रात बैठ के काम किया क्योंकि इतनी खुशी थी हमें हमारे पास में पहली बार काम आया था तो फिर उन्हें विश्वास हो गया कि वास्तव में ये काम करने वाले हैं और काम करेंगे तो फिर हमारे उन्होंने ऑर्डर ला के दिया हमें और अब मैंने सोचा कि मैं इतनी तकलीफ से गुजरी हूँ और आज मेरे पास में थोड़े बहुत पैसे आए इससे मैं कितनी खुश हूँ तो ऐसी और कितनी महिलाएं हैं जो गांव में बैठी हैं जिनके पास में मतलब बिल्कुल रोजगार नहीं है और वो अपने मन से काम नहीं कर पा रही, उन महिलाओं को भी साथ में जोड़ती हूँ। तो वहाँ पे 50 डिग्री प्लस टेम्परेचर रहता है और जाने के लिए गाड़ी नहीं, रेत के टीले हैं और बिना चप्पल के जाना, उन घरों तक पहुँचना, पीने के लिए पानी तक नहीं था। लेकिन वहाँ जाने के बाद भी घर के लोग बोलते कि आप जो हमारी महिलाएं घर का काम कर रही हैं वो भी छुड़वाओगे, ये कर रही हो यही इनके लिए बहुत है, आप क्या करोगे, आप आज काम दोगे कल ये हमारा कहना मानेगी नहीं मानेगी, आप हमारे घर मत आना। हम बोलते नहीं, हम घर आएंगे, हम काम दे के जाएंगे, ये घर का काम भी करेगी, आपका कहना भी मानेगी, लेकिन दिन में जो भी इनके पास में 2-3 घंटे टाइम बचेगा उसमें ये काम करेगी। तो फिर कुछ महिलाएं तैयार हुई और जब उनके पास में इनकम आने लगी तो घर वाले भी साथ देने लगे कि वास्तव में ये तो घर का सपोर्ट कर रही है। तो और महिलाएं साथ में जुड़ना शुरू हुई। अब हमारे लिए और चैलेंज था कि इतनी महिलाओं के लिए ऑर्डर कहाँ से लेके आए। फिर किसी ने बोला कि आप ऐसा करो एग्जीबिशन करो। अब एग्जीबिशन हमने तो कभी बाड़मेर शहर भी ठीक से नहीं देखा, एग्जीबिशन कहाँ करें। पहले तो ऐसा होता था कि गांव के लोग बनाते थे और गांव के ही खरीदते थे, लेकिन अब ये है कि हाथ का काम गांव के लोग करते हैं लेकिन शहर में खरीदते हैं। तो फिर हमने एक मौका मिला दिल्ली में एग्जीबिशन का, और जब वहाँ हम गए तो हमारी 10 से 15 हज़ार की सेल हुई और उससे हमें हिम्मत बंधी कि वास्तव में ये काम को पसंद किया जाता है और अपन और कोशिश करेंगे तो और अच्छा हो सकता है। तो हमने वापस जाके पूरी तैयारी की, 1 साल की तैयारी की और नेक्स्ट एग्जीबिशन में हमारी 11 लाख की सेल हुई। उसके बाद हम पीछे हटने वाले नहीं थे और महिलाएं साथ में जुड़ी और हमने सोचा क्यों ना इसको, अभी तक तो हम होम फिनिशिंग के आइटम बना रहे थे जो कुशन कवर, बेड कवर, कर्टन्स, लेकिन जो पहनने के कपड़े बनाएंगे तो लोग और भी ज़्यादा खरीदेंगे। तो हमने कुर्ती, दुपट्टे, साड़ीज ये बनाना शुरू किया, लेकिन ये फोल्ड किए हो किसी को पता नहीं चलेगा कि ये पहने वो कैसा लगेगा। तो हमारे दिमाग में आया क्यों ना फैशन शो किया जाए। लेकिन फैशन शो मतलब एक मन में डर था कि फैशन शो सिर्फ शॉर्ट कपड़े पहनते हैं, लेकिन हमने सोचा हम हमारे कपड़ों के फैशन शो जरूर करेंगे। लेकिन हमने जब एक फैशन शो हो रहा था तो हमने रिक्वेस्ट किया कि हमें फैशन शो करना है, तो वो बोले आप आर्टिजन हो, आप क्या फैशन शो करोगे, आप जो आप पे काम कर रहे हैं वही आपके लिए बैठ रहे हैं, ये आपके लायक नहीं है। तो फिर हमने सोचा नहीं हमें करना तो है। तो राजस्थान हेरिटेज वीक हो रहा था, वहाँ जाके हमने ट्राई किया, तो उन्होंने पहले तो यही बोला लेकिन फिर हमें मौका दिया। और उसके बाद चैलेंज था कि कॉस्ट्यूम डिज़ाइन कैसे करेंगे, वहाँ पे बड़े डिज़ाइनर आ रहे थे जो अब्रह्मण ठाकुर है, बिबिरा सेल है, हेमंत त्रिवेदी है, उन सब लोगों के बीच में जाके फैशन शो कैसे करोगे आप। तो मैंने सोचा कि करेंगे हम जरूर।
एंड हर फादर हैड अ सेकंड मैरिज, she has 7 sisters and when she was in 8th grade she was made to leave school. She got married at the age of 17 and her family had a lot of financial problems, and because of health issues she lost her first child, and that is when she had extremely suicidal thoughts. She didn't want to live further, she didn't have the will to live anymore, but she decided that no, I have to find some work to do. And but she realized, I am not educated, I can't go out of my house, what work can I find, what work will somebody give me. She even considered cleaning houses or doing daily wage labor in the construction areas in her village. But the one thing that she did think of was that her grandmother had taught her how to sew and embroider. There was no market for it at that time, but she just decided that she needs to get started with it. But eventually she realized that she can't do it alone and she needs to invest in a machine that will get her to make more clothing and items. And she spoke to 10 other women in the village and she told them that they decided to contribute 100 rupees each. And they got a second-hand machine and she managed to convince 10 other women to come together and start sewing together. But now the challenge was, where do we get so much volume of work that we can keep 10 women engaged and employed? So where do we get that work from? So the organization that she's currently the president of, she approached them back then. And they told them that you know what, we are interested in this and we want you to help us. But the people who were running the organization were very skeptical. They said that no, women come here and work, but they're very irregular, they don't show up the next day. So we don't have faith or trust in like being able to employ you or provide you orders. But they implored, and finally the people agreed that fine, we'll give you like a sampling job to do. You have 3 days to do this. And come back to us after 3 days. The next day, these 10 women went to them, and the people of the organization were ready in saying that you have clearly proved that you don't want to come back and you won't be able to do the job. But the women said, we have worked all night and we have gotten your order ready overnight. So the very next day, they actually came back with the entire sampling order, which gave the organization some trust in these women, and they decided to provide them more orders. And then she realized that, like, for the first time in her life, she was able to earn some money. And the kind of happiness it gave her, she was convinced that she needed to provide this opportunity to other women as well. To have that sort of happiness and belief in oneself because of earning one's own money. So she got more women connected, and it was a very challenging task because this area is an area where households don't have water. It's a completely deserted area. And the main constraints from the women were that their families believed that these women would turn rebellious. They would not listen to their in-laws, or they would not do the housework anymore. They would not have time to do the housework anymore. But Ruma Devi convinced them that no, they will also do housework, and in their spare time, they'll do some stitching on the side. And once the income started coming, the household also saw that these women were clearly contributing to the household income. So that led to more women joining her in her mission to provide them economic opportunity and financial independence. Now the next challenge that came was, again, there were so many women, where do we get all of these orders from? Where do we get a market from? So this, they decided to do an exhibition, and the challenge was that initially anything that would be made in the village would be sold in villages, but now you could also, you could make things in villages but sell the same items in cities because there was a demand for it. So the first exhibition that they did was in the national capital of India, Delhi. And they made about 10 to 15,000 rupees. And that kind of reaffirmed the belief that there is some sort of demand and support for these products. And these women decided that they can do better. So the next year they did the same exhibition in Delhi. And they earned 11 lakhs. Just through the sale of these products. What they had earned last year was 10 to 15,000, and the next year their revenue went up to 11 lakhs. The next item sort of on their agenda was actually diversifying their products. So then they realized that they had been making cushion covers up to that point, and they decided to also start getting into fashion clothing and items. So they decided to start stitching kurtis or generally ladies' clothing. But then they realized this problem that women won't know how it will look on them. So they decided that the answer to that was to hold a fashion show. Now the idea of holding a fashion show in a place like Barmer with women from a rural area was extremely unconventional, and it would be questioned. And the idea that they had about fashion show was that it involved short clothes, because that was the kind of notion that existed about fashion shows. And but they decided to still do it. They were questioned again and again that artisans cannot do fashion shows. This isn't for you. That is what they were told again and again. But then they finally approached the Rajasthan Heritage Week, and they felt intimidated. There were extremely major designers. There were big designers, and they were thinking about how they're going to do it. But they did it. They designed the clothes themselves, and the artisans, the women, did the ramp walk themselves. So that really helped in convincing and showing people that these are the women who are making your clothes. This is where you're getting your clothes from. And yes, they received a standing ovation, and that was just, I think these are like the sort of different steps that really reaffirm that they can make a difference in their own lives and also the lives of other women around them.
So very inspiring stories from all of them, men. You know, some themes of family running, some of passion and determination. But, you know, each of these women have worked in very different areas. and have shown different strengths. Of course, there are barriers and challenges that they've overcome, but how they've done it and how, let's dive into that. Ms. Moudgil, you have been a female IPS officer in a very male-dominated system, and you've fought against corruption and stood up against some extremely powerful people. Yeah? And how did you find that courage and the strength to fight for what is right, especially when all the challenges were stacked up against you?
I believe courage is a habit. You act courageously in one situation, you get reinforced to behave the same way in another. It takes you, it makes you more courageous in many more situations. But having said that, it's also a bit of a trait that I have. I don't know, I speak up my mind. And speaking up, you know, or standing up for things, especially in a male-dominated department like the police department, definitely is not very easy. And when you speak up, it is considered as, you know, you're attacking the man's world. So then, you know, everybody gets up and tries to, you know, either keep it hush-hush, or they try to silence you, or behave as if nothing has happened, and so on. So when I gave this expose report on corruption and special privileges being given to convicts, especially one prisoner who was not a VIP prisoner designated by the court, she was a very ordinary prisoner as per court orders, but flouting Supreme Court order, flouting prison manual, she was given privileges simply because she happened to be powerful. She was once slated to be the chief minister of my neighboring state, that is Tamil Nadu. Once Jayalalitha died, she was her close aide and she was herself slated to be the chief minister. But as luck would have it, she ended up in jail. But there also she lived almost like in her home with five rooms, a big corridor to walk about, her own kitchen and so on. When I gave this expose report, many eyebrows were raised in the system itself. There were people who didn't try to believe. It's when an IAS or an IPS report officer who is in that place reports on something, it is taken for granted. It is taken as truth. But my report was kind of questioned, doubted, and there was an independent inquiry committee set up to find out the truth. And the independent inquiry committee went into the details and gave the report same as what I had reported. And at that point of time, there was a lot of confusion going on. This was a huge news in the media because it involved a very high-profile person as Ms. Shashikala. And it was important for them politically. So it became a national news. It went on for months together as to the people were asking me what is happening and so on. Now there were my own people who were, in the sense, my own colleagues who were all silent. They were watching with bated breath as to what will happen. Because generally in the system, when you raise voice, when you expose something, the system just tries to get rid of such a person, the so-called disruptor. Anything can happen. Governments, without applying mind, can just suspend you from service for a short time, punish you and set up an inquiry committee against you, whatnot. And people will always, the other officers also will, you know, work to find out, to dig in your past, what have you done in the past, something where you could be held responsible and you could be countered for this. But luckily, I had no skeletons in my cupboard and I didn't have anything to cover up. And I believed that as a public servant, we draw salary from taxpayers' money, it is public money. So I believe we have to be publicly accountable to the public and act in a manner most transparent as possible. But that is definitely against the work culture even today, sadly, but I hope it will change. And one is courage, to take on whatever comes. Because ultimately I thought, yes, government could punish me. There were people who said, Mannarguddy Mafia, the person whom you have upset, whom you have exposed that she was taking privileges, they will not leave you. That's what some people said. Some said government will now act against you. All sorts of opinions were given to discourage me. But then I said, fine, bring it on. Let's see. Because I have nothing to cover up and I will face it to the end. And even if I have to approach court, I'll do it. And ultimately, I'm not in the wrong in this issue and I'll fight it out. That was my thought in mind. So probably that kept me going against all odds. And that clarity helps. And many a time, I still believe we have to give information to people. We have the Right to Information Act today in India. In spite of that, you don't get information. Bureaucrats just hold on information as if it's some treasure. I don't understand. When somebody applies, an RTI applicant, he applies for any information from the government, I don't know. They just, the bureaucrats just perceive him as an enemy. Oh, you are questioning me. You are asking information from me. This is the attitude they have in mind. And any information that you are supposed to give under RTI, so you can always do self-disclosure, and that is what I did. And I gave the exposure report. It somehow became it came in the media, and there also I kept answering questions within my permitted limits of my service rules. I can't criticize the government, but of course I can always expose the act, because that is an act of corruption. I believe is to be exposed. It has to be dealt in a transparent manner and not in a hush-hush manner, and that is what I did. And yes, the luckily the government didn't take any punitive action because of the humongous public support that I got. Though my own colleagues or the system didn't support me, there was a thunderous applaud I could hear from the public, and that kept me going. So the common man in India still stands up, you know, for officers who work honestly, sincerely. So I think that kept me going. Clarity and courage, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much. We'll keep that in mind for us. Clarity, courage, and don't have skeletons in your closet. Mrs. Agarwal, you climbed the Everest at 47, all the summits at 50. As a housewife at that age, society's expecting something very different, you know, from people of your age in the society you were in. But how did you where did you get that motivation from to start something like this at such an age, at this age? Premlata ji, wo aapne 47 ki umr mein Everest climb kiya, 50 ki umr mein sare peaks climb kar diye. समाज आपसे ये एक्सपेक्ट नहीं कर रहा था, उनके हिसाब से आपको घर पर होना था, कुछ और करना था, अपनी जान गंवाने एवरेस्ट नहीं जाना था. तो वो कौन सा जुनून था जिसके कारण आप वो हासिल कर पाई हैं जो आज आप हैं?
एक्चुअली हमारे जीवन में, सबके जीवन में एक लक्ष्य तो जरूर होता है, एक एम कि आपको क्या करना है लाइफ में. मेरा एम था मुझे अपने देश के तिरंगे को सर्वोच्च शिखर पर पहुंचाना है. और जब मैं माउंटेन जा रही थी तो बस एक जुनून था कैसे मैं अपने देश के तिरंगे को हाईएस्ट पीक पर लेके जाऊं. और वो जुनून कहाँ से आया? मैं तो एक नॉर्मल हाउसवाइफ थी जिसको समाज ने कभी एक्सेप्ट नहीं किया. जब मैं अब फिटनेस के लिए दौड़ती थी तो मेरी आज से 15 साल पहले 20 साल पहले मेरी सास को सुनना पड़ता था कि आपकी बहू ट्रैक सूट पहन के दौड़ रही है, क्या वो पहाड़ चढ़ेगी? घर संसार क्यों नहीं देखती है? बच्चों को क्यों नहीं देखती है? वो घर आप अलाउ कैसे करते हो अपनी बहू को? मुझे एक जगह बनानी पड़ी क्योंकि आज से 20 साल पहले इस फील्ड में मेल भी आने से घबराते थे. और एक हाउसवाइफ उसका तो ड्यूटी था बस घर संसार देखना, बच्चों तक ही सीमित थी क्योंकि मेरी शादी भी 18 साल की एज में हो गई थी, 19 साल में बच्चे पैदा हो गए थे. तो बहुत चैलेंजेस का मुझे सामना करना पड़ा था। जब मैं एवरेस्ट के लिए जा रही थी तो मेरी बड़ी बेटी मुझे सी ऑफ करने आई थी काठमांडू में, और वो वापस चली गई तो गाइड ने पूछा कि आपकी बेटी क्यों चली गई। तो उस मैंने कहा वो तो मुझे छोड़ने आई थी। बोला उसको एवरेस्ट नहीं जाना है। मैंने कहा एवरेस्ट मैं जा रही हूँ। बोला क्यों मजाक कर रही है, दादी नानी बनने की उम्र में और एक इंडियन लेडी एवरेस्ट जाएगी, जाइए घर में बैठ के पकौड़े खाइए। एंड जब भी मुझे उसकी ज़रूरत पड़ती वो मुझे डिमोरलाइज करता था कि यहाँ मरने क्यों आ गई है। सोचिए हमारे भारत, मतलब सभी जगह, नेपाल में भी भारतीय महिला की क्या छवि है कि 50 साल की हो गई तो अब वो शारीरिक रूप से एकदम कमज़ोर हो गई है। और मैंने किसी हद तक इस छवि को बदलने की कोशिश की है कि हम भारतीय महिलाएं किसी भी फील्ड में किसी से पीछे नहीं हैं। और ये जुनून हमें है, हमें इसकी पहचान नहीं है। मैं ऐसी महिलाओं को ट्रेनिंग देती हूँ जो बोलती है कि मेरा बैक में प्रॉब्लम है, नी प्रॉब्लम है, अब मैं कुछ नहीं कर सकती, और मैं उनको लेके जाती हूँ क्योंकि हमारे अंदर भगवान ने इतनी क्षमता दी है कि हमें खुद नहीं पता। और जब डिफ़िकल्टीज़ में आते हैं तब अपने आप को पहचानने का मौका मिलता है। जैसे कि मुझे पता चला कि हमारे अंदर कितना एंडोरेंस पावर है, और इसीलिए मैं यहाँ तक पहुँच पाई हूँ। थैंक यू।